Myself, Rituraj Ghosh. I'll start my session with basics of metal cutting. Oxyfuel gas cutting, as you know, this is a common thing which we can see every day almost in our projects, in our shop floors everywhere. It's the most widely used cutting process. And this is suitable for uses a wide range of fuel gas like acetylene, propane, LPG, methane, hydrogen, etc., but used in foundries for cutting of. Now, what is the process of gas cutting? First thing, a ring of preheat flames in the cutting nozzle that we have to create. That means before cutting, we have to preheat the area at about 850 degrees centigrade, not more than that, because after that, it will melt. That if we heat more, it may melt the top surface and the cutting will not be smooth one. And at 850 degrees, spontaneous oxidation takes place in the presence of pure oxygen. This oxygen is provided through a central orifice in the nozzle. Just a moment. You can see this is the central orifice. And then the heated steel is converted into a fluid oxide slag, which is blown. When you are pressing the this torch handle, then the cutting oxygen comes through the central orifice. And then fluid oxide slag is blowing down. And how this cutting cutting is occurred. And note is there. Acetylene main valve should only be opened half turn. And the regulator set at 5 to 7 psi for cutting. The oxygen should be set between 15 to 25 psi. And if somebody is welding there, the oxygen welding is there, that time set to 7 to 10 psi. Okay, now, actually this is also called chemical cutting. So, because there is some chemical reaction is also takes place. So which are, say, here I am shown the 2C2 plus H2 plus 2O2, acetylene plus oxygen, this comes to 4CO carbon monoxide and 2H2. The combustion also continues in the secondary or outer zone. Outer zone, this is the primary zone, and the secondary zone, where is the equation is 4CO plus 2H2O plus 3O2, 4CO2 plus 2H2O. As the oxygen chemically combines with the iron exothermically, because it's exothermically, is generally referred to as the cutting jet. A tremendous amount of heat is liberated when the high purity oxygen unites with the steel during this reaction. There are some reactions are there. See, iron plus oxygen, it is coming iron oxide plus heat, about 63,800 calories. This is the first reaction. Then the second reaction, Fe plus 2O2, Fe3O4. That is magnetite, I think. So second reaction, and then this hematite is coming. This third reaction, but this is for the heavier thickness plate. But for the maximum flame temperature, the ratio of the volume of oxygen to fuel gas is 1.2:1 for acetylene and 4.3:1 for propane or LPG. So you can understand that oxyacetylene, though acetylene is costlier, but the quantity of oxygen is requiring very less with reference to this LPG or propane. So finally, the cutting cost is getting lower. This is just one equipment. This is the cutting torch and this is the welding torch in the same way. Is used to control to minimize the cylinder pressure, and it is becoming to the cutting pressure. So this for that only we use the regulator. And this there are two. So oxygen hose is always blue and red or orange, whatever may be, that is the fuel gas color. So we should not mix this together. And just below the torch and just after the regulator, there should be flashback arrestors. because we have to protect ourselves. And this is just a schematic diagram, though there is showing five holes, but it's actually six. This is the torchet, this is the nozzles, and this is the preheat frame is coming, heating oxygen with mixing with acetylene. So all the way, all the holes are coming with this. And in centrally, this is the cutting oxygen. When we press the handle, the flow. This is after heating at 850 degree centigrade. Then we start this cutting jet. Well, there is just two types of oxygen nozzle I have shown. This is the oxyacetylene nozzle. You can see the centrally the cutting this oxygen hole, and this is the oxy LPG nozzle where this holes are little inside. Anyhow, this is oxyacetylene, some thickness and nozzle sizes are given. So is maximum plate thickness 1225 like this, and the nozzle size is this, and the cutting oxygen pressure is this one. You can take a snap if you require, but you can remember, of course. Okay, so this is the types of flames when we during the cutting or welding, whatever, maybe when oxygen and fuel gas is we burn them, there are three types of gas are coming out. One is three types of flames. One is neutral flame. You can see the neutral flames are the top one, how it is looks like. It is the correct mixture. It is equally and greenish rounded inner cone. This one rounded inner cone, and this is mainly used for the welding. But ours is mainly will for cut flame. Excess of O2, because you can understand that when we are giving more O2 pressure, then only it is cutting. So oxidizing flame, bluish sharp inner cone, and then reducing flame where the fuel gas percentage is more, and long white luminous feather. This mainly used for hot pressing or this type of things. Okay, now hottest point of the flame is the inner tip of the inner cone, where for acetylene it is 3160 degree centigrade, and for LPG it is 2820 degree centigrade, and this is the secondary flame. But consider this one for the cutting. You see this one, this is the some comparison heat concentration. This is for the oxyacetylene. You see the penetration part cutting, and this is the oxy LPG penetration part. See, total kilojoule per cubic meter is more in LPG, but the primary heat concentration is more in oxyacetylene, and that is why, and the flame temperature, that is why it is more effective. More effective means also economic also. A comparative fuel gas performance, oxyacetylene can put more heat as compared to LPG propane. What I told, the flame temperature in primary one is 3160, for LPG or propane it is 2820. Consequently, quicker preheating to oxidation temperature at start, and also as cut progresses, resulting in for the oxyacetylene faster piercing and 15 to 45% higher cutting speed than LPG or propane. Less distortion, cuts through rust and mill scale better, because many times we can face this type of problem where some scales are there, and generally gives superior cutting quality. And I told you earlier that oxyacetylene is the only flame which can weld steel. But drop of oxygen purity will increase the oxygen consumption and will decrease the cutting speed. That we have to think. So we should not drop the oxygen pressure. And this is the cutting progress. So it is going from this side to this side, and there is some drag lines are there. This is a cutting stream. And what type of defects are coming? Say fluted out and gouging at the bottom. That means flute, it is coming round and round shape. And because of low speed, top is melt. Large preheat flame or oxygen pressure low. As I told you, if more than 850 degree we heat this, that means preheat flame place, and it may be some reducing flame may come, and that time this top edge may melt, and heavy flag because of large preheat flame also. Now, what are the safety? Always use safety goggles, wear safety shoes, leather gloves, and apron. Do not draw more than 50% acetylene content per hour from a cylinder, because acetone is there, liquid and it may come out. So always use cylinder in upright position with securely tight. Always use correct hose, regulator, and fitting. Always use a striker to light the cutting torch. Striker means this gas light for burning this gas torch. There is a special type of this striker is available. Don't try with some cloth with fire or with matchsticks, something like that, or welding electro spark. Do not use oxygen torch in a closed space. Do not use copper piping or parts in acetylene line. Never use acetylene at a pressure higher than 1 kg. Then it may be flammable or something may be there. Always use flashback arrestor to protect from backfires. The backfire, immediately shut the oxygen supply and then shut up fuel gas supply. That means whenever backfire is there, first we have to close the oxygen supply, because with the help of oxygen only this fire starts, because fuel gas alone cannot burn. Okay, so cylinder, how to keep the cylinders normally? So fuel gas and oxygen cylinders, when you are storing it, I'm talking about stores, it should be 20 feet apart, or if we can put one barrier in between, so say half hour fire resistance ready, then it can be 5 feet apart. This is for the storing. Plasma cutting, just to brief only. So this is the variant of tick process, like high frequency start, learned tick process earlier. So like high frequency start, everything is like that, where the constricted by a copper nozzle to give temperatures over 20,000 degrees centigrade. It's not less, it is over 20,000 degrees centigrade, maybe 30,000 also. Inert and active gases, including air, can cut all metals and widely used for stainless steel, aluminium, copper, and nickel alloys. And rather, but it is a noisy process, of course. Now, the fourth state of matter, what is that? That is a plasma. So when we this is a solid thing, say ice, if the heat energy is coming to liquid, then if we heat it more, then it's making steam, and then if we heat more or the heat energy is further exists, then it's called plasma, because it is ionized. Then see the formation, this sort of these molecule structure with tight together, liquid little loose, gaseous, it is more spread, and this is the plasma one, where you can ions positive and negative, then you can see molecular fragment with, and in the plasma, this, because it is ionized state, fourth state of matter. Now, plasma cutting, transferred arc with high gas flow is used. High gas flow here. Gases like argon, nitrogen, or argon, helium used with tungsten electrode, because we, as I told, TIG welding also uses a tungsten electrode. Used mainly for stainless steel, aluminium, nickel alloys, etc. Actually, which materials do not form oxides. And torch position is 90 degree to metal surface. That means it is 90 degree perpendicular. Now just a small video. Oxidizing gases, AR or oxygen, can be used with a hafnium electrode mounted on a copper holder cutting mild steel. Cut quality is slightly poor with the air plasma due to excessive top edge melt. And there are two variants, dual gas and water injection. Dual gas, it is something like this. So here comes the gas through this, and there is something, your secondary gas, and there is the primary gas. And here it's water injection. You see, there is the ceramic nozzles is there. The water injection is from there, and there is the primary gas is coming. So cutting gas is nitrogen here, and copper through the copper nozzle. Okay, now laser cutting. CO2 lasers use CO2 and pure helium as lasing gas. So lasing gas, what are there? Carbon dioxide and pure helium. And acid gas laser cutting to eject the molten metal from the cut. Say argon nitrogen can be used for stainless steel, aluminium and titanium. Oxygen can be used for mild steel and low alloy steel. Laser gives very high quality cutting. You see, this is the laser this resonator. From here, it is coming to this mirror, and it is coming to passing through this focus lens, and it's coming here cutting. And laser gas is coming from here. So one is their laser resonator. That is maybe I can show you this. You can tell it. Yeah. Laser focus a beam of monochromatic light to a very small point to give power densities of 10^5 watt per millimeter square. A flexible process can be used for welding, cutting, heat treatment, 3D machining, engraving, etc. And for many, many metal cutting, you see many shapes. Just a small video.
Metal cutting technology will truly set you apart. This innovative technology is compatible with Kern's full line of laser systems. The metal cutting technology allows for laser processing of stainless steel, mild steel, aluminum, and other light gauge metals without the high operational costs of a large multi-kilowatt laser. You will be amazed at the sheet metal applications that fall within Kern's metal cutting capabilities. The automatic focusing height follower, which was developed by Kern Lasers, is one of the key elements for consistent measurement tables. Pulled by a capacitance sensor and Z-axis motor, the block will be cut and the cutting knots can be adjusted and is obtained. The height follower will track the surface of the metal and adjust the nozzle in the Z-axis, maintaining a constant focus point while the metal is being cut. The metal cutting table is constructed of a durable steel gridwork, which minimizes the surface contact with the bottom side of the metal being cut. defined by 10 sheet of metal will fit comfortably onto Kern's largest cutting table. An assist gas, such as oxygen or nitrogen, is injected through the metal cutting nozzle, resulting in a dross-free cut edge, requiring little or no deburring. The KCAM software allows cool offset and nozzle air pressure. Our largest 400-watt laser can cut up to 4.8-millimeter mild steel, 2-millimeter stainless steel with nitrogen assist, and up to 1.5-millimeter aluminum. A lens protector known as a K-focusing lens and the metal being cut, protecting the optic from reflection and pitting. The K lenses are economically priced to allow for daily or weekly replacement. The products that can be created with our metal cutting options are endless. From control panels to interior design, our productive and accurate metal cutting technology will be the perfect fit for your business needs.
Okay, so I have completed the first part. This metal cutting, this was the basics of metal cutting. We cannot go deeper for this, but now the topic will be more interesting, I think, more required, these topics. Is it visible now? Second one is visible?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. So now we are going ahead with a very, what I'll tell, which is required, more required, because we fast, but we don't follow normally. But now we'll go through welding step. To start, we have to go through some workplace safety also. Okay, welding is used extensively as a major process in fabrication and manufacturing products ranging from nano components to massive steel structure. As in other processes of manufacture, welding has also specific hazards which are to be mitigated for the safety of all concerned to create a productive environment. Welding and cutting are no doubt when sufficient measures are taken, adopted, and adhered to protect the welder from potential hazards. Now we'll go for workplace. So what is the workplace? So before welding, we should discuss first about the workplace and related incidents where welding is to be carried out. The workplace incidents, what are faulty equipment, working environment, which includes disorder at the workplace, noise, temperature, ventilation, lighting, and then the workforce. Workforce means those who work directly, that is, job experience may be less, so that there may be problem. Information on methodology, be knowing the they may not pass the information to them, and the age. So all these are considered. So benefits of healthy workplace, you can see increased productivity level, reduced staff turnover, improved company image, reduced absenteeism, employee morale. Now just a small video for the safety. Ventilation through windows and openings. So this type of things, heat and so ventilation is required. Radiation from roofs and walls are minimized. Then hot surfaces are insulated. Air is circulated by maybe in hot places we can use between the heat source and the workers. Overcoming or uncomfortable draughts by air. Air conditioning is avoided. Sufficient breaks are provided in workplace, and cold drinking water must be there. And then lighting. So we have to fix the lights in such a way that the glare should not. That we have to take care. Lamps and fittings are cleaned regularly. Then the noise. Important things. Noisy parts or machines are enclosed or covered completely. That we have to ensure. Machines are regularly serviced, otherwise some sounds will come, of course. Sound absorbing materials are used at ceilings, walls, or machine covers. Workers in most noisy workplaces are rotated to avoid long hours of exposure. And transmission of vibration from machines to hands is damped as much as possible, and earplugs to be used. Because normally, you see, where the noise level is exceeds 85 to 90 dBA, so we have to use earplug. If you are unable to speak in a normal tone of voice, standing at arm's length from your workmate, then the noise level is too high. That means normally, if we cannot talk together, then it is a high noisy area. You see. So when 10 dBA is nothing, whisper or nightlifes or something like that, just going up is 120 for the jet, this 130 for the rock band, something like that. Is it diesel truck? It is so they're just some examples. You can get it in the internet. And they will look like, see, normal, this is our 8 hours, I can consume this much, 85. And then when it is more and more, then we have to consume less. If it is 106 dBA, then we must not be within this noise level by 3 minutes 45 seconds, more than that. Well, so these are the some levels. Well-being. So if there is happiness at work, what will then? Personality pattern will change, social connections will be there, autonomy and decision making will be better, financial security is there, school, acceptance and empathy, challenges and diversity of tasks, and work-life balance. So total will be there if happiness is there at the workplace. Now, definition of safety. The condition or state of being safe. This is the main thing. The condition or state of being safe. We have to be safe at the workplace. Freedom from danger and hazard, and exemption from heart injury or loss. Safety means keeping yourself and others free from harm or dangers. Not only myself, others also. It means taking care not to fall or bump. Also means to avoid accidents by being careful with what you are doing. Safety in the workplace means having an end and hazards. And industrial safety is the provision and maintenance of plant, machinery, storage, and everything. So, risk, hazard, and safety. What is the risk? The faith and trust required to suspend uncertainty to take an action. That means we are taking risk. So we use this word too, because we have some faith. And hazard, an object that is imagined to have the potential for harm. And safety is a temporary moment when physical harm is low. It is not this in this throughout. So confined space, if it is you work in a confined space, what is to be done? What is confined space? Being large to enter and perform work. Only large enough, not too much. Has limited or restricted means for entry or exit, and is not designed for continuous occupancy. This, what we have to consider? Ventilation, oxygen content we have to check. It should be 19.5 to securing cylinder and machinery. It should be outside. Emergency rescue team must be there. Electrode, if there is arc welding, its electrode must be removable. That must be there. Gas cylinder shut off, and then warning signs for hot metal, low voltage battery operated light should be inside, and trained workforce with necessary work permit. That means there is a actually every plant there is a training for confined space, then only people can go inside this. And just a schematic diagram. So this is a confined space. This is the there are watch standby worker is there. This is breathing apparatus is there, and there is, you see, the fume extractor is there, and lifeline. So all these are there, and this is the same thing. It is written there. What I told you earlier is a confined space. Now we will go for the welding safety. Safety in welding, what is that? Welding is no doubt a safe occupation when sufficient measures are taken, adopted, and adhered to protect the welder from potential hazard. The risk is doing the job, but also those who are working nearby. Every manufacturing unit using machineries and equipment impose hazards which are to be mitigated by all concerned. Okay, so main hazards, what are there? These are the main hazards for welding: fumes and electrical shocks, arc radiation, and musculoskeletal disorder. This people are not taking care of the last one. General guidelines for safety during welding: workplace must be inspected to ensure that sparks or molten metal won't fall on workers or combustible material. Welding in a hazardous area is prohibited without proper work permit. Welders must take proper protection during welding. Fire extinguisher and fire blanket should be kept near the welding area. Welding equipment must be in good operative condition. Welding lead and hoses to be kept off the walkways and stairways. Never weld on barrels, tanks, or pipe that may have contained combustible or unknown material. The frame of welding equipment must be grounded, and while welding, nearby personnel must be protected from arc rays by non-combustible screens. And now we'll go for the personal protective equipment. This we everybody knows. So during any, not only welding, so other job also we have to use this. This is coverall or boiler suit, apron, hand gloves, safety helmet, welding helmet, goggles, leg guards, like this actually, earplugs. So all this have to taken care. And this is just a few examples of PPEs. This is helmet with respirator. So respirator, this supply is there from here. There is buttons. So this oxygen flows from here. So this is very costly, of course. This is just small video for PPE.
personal protective equipment, PPE. Use of personal protective equipments, PPEs. Avoid exposure to the hazards when controls are not feasible or effective in reducing these exposures to acceptable levels. Mandatory PPE, safety helmet, hard hat.
Impact and penetration of falling, flying and stationary objects. Safety shoe. Workers performing tasks which potentially expose them to hazards, such as operating a ground temper or chipping, shall wear safety goggles to prevent employee eye exposure by requiring all workers and projects to enforce eye protection cues. Impact resistant safety glasses with side shields. Prescription lens with side shields. Vented safety goggles. Non-vented safety goggles. Task-specific PPEs, hearing protection. Many construction and manufacturing activities are overexposed to noise. Exposure can damage hearing loss prevention and other hazards on the job.
You can see through this, that's PPE, and most effective is the PPE, then change the way people work, then engineering from the hazard, and then substitution, replace the hazard and eliminate. That is the most effective part. And now feel. That's due to fume. This is the first particle, and this is the air. Micron range, this is atmospheric dust, welding fumes. Then invisible pollution from particulate matters and pollutant gases generated from various sources. Serious effects on welders' health over time. There's welding smoke and gases, which includes chromium, asbestos, manganese. Causing agents like include cadmium, nickel, beryllium, chromium, etc. All are cancer causing. And the following effects: short term effect and long term effect. So short term is long-term events over the time it is coming. Short-term effects irritate the eyes, nose, chest, respiratory tract, shortness of breath, etc. Casual loss of appetite, vomiting. And long-term, welders have an increased risk of lung cancer and possibly cancer of the larynx and urinary tract. Welders may experience a variety of chronic respiratory problems like bronchitis, asthma, like this. So prevention from welding smoke is extremely necessary to avoid health hazard. That's why we are using extractor, fume extractor, like this. You can see fume extractor. So source of fumes, what are they? From parent metal, metallic fumes generated by heating, oxides formed by heat and cutting. Surface treatment, chemical cleaning of surface, degreasing chemicals, anti-spatter sprays, surface coating, galvanizing and other metallic coating, paint, plastic coatings, all can be the source of fumes. And surrounding air, formation of ozone, nitrogen, dioxides, carbon monoxide, other oxides, What is the prevention? Source of fumes again. Shielding gas. From shielding gas also, it is the source of fumes. Carbon dioxide splits and carbon monoxide. Higher level exposure. Lack of oxygen. Leakage of this gas, all this gas, and from consumable also. SMAW flux coating. This is the maximum, of course. Copper fumes from GMAWs and welding flux. So what should be the prevention? Proper ventilation, use of extractor, fresh air supply, drying of clean surfaces, and proper welding process. Welding process is also the cause for fume. Don't have to, because you cannot limit what can be. For the carbon dioxide, this time-weighted average is this one. 1000 ppm, but the STEL, that is short term exposure limit, 30,000, up to 30,000 for short term. I think some measurement has given, you can net, but maximum, you can see this. I should tell, maximum is the flux code wear. This is maybe TW. Oh, sorry, an 8-hour time-weighted average of 5 milligram per cubic meter for welding fumes measured inside the welder's breathing zone. So, in 8 hours, a welder can go up to 5 mm. So, this should be the surrounding air. This is the recommended explosion. So, hazard, so safe. The issues of fire and explosion hazards in fusion welding process must be safeguarded for welders to work safe and to obtain the best possible accident-free shop floor operation, resulting high productivity. And this from intense fires. So, the source of fires, you can see there are mainly three things. First thing is the fuel, combustible material. Then oxygen, and then heat. When these three are getting together, then the fire starts. Prevention. Fire hazards should be removed if the welded object cannot be readily moved, because we cannot always shift the welded object, because maybe a heavy structure we cannot shift. So fire hazard must be removed from there. Guard should be used if removing fire hazard is not possible. Smoking should not be allowed near the workplace. Welders or welding operators should wear non-synthetic and fire-resistant clothes. Fire extinguishers and other fire extinguishing equipment must be readily available. Fire watch for 30 minutes to be ensured after welding and cutting wherever necessary. That means, what is fire watch? That means after welding, you have to check for 30 minutes, and there should not be any flammable material by this time. And combustible materials to be kept at least 35 feet away from welding and cutting. A restriction to be welding allowed if none of the above is possible. Then we should. And there are different types of fire extinguisher. Just you may know, or just you hear this one. There are A, B, C, D, E, C, D, K types are there. But this is actually the old one which we are following. There are little different in ISO standards. A is a class A fire is for involves common combustibles such as wood, paper, like this. And class B fire involves flammable liquid, solvent, oil, gasoline, paints, etc. Class C fire involves energized electrical equipment. Class D fire involves combustible metals such as magnesium, lithium, etc. Class K fires involve combustible cooking media when cooking. So mainly we are dealing with A. It in the market, A is which can extinguish a fire. It's ABC multi-purpose. Rescue from fire and explosion, immediate warning and caution through alarm. Ensure emergency exits are not blocked. Floor rescue plan is in place. Cut off power supply. Nobody gets panicked. Ensure nobody is trapped. Assemble in the pre-assembled. Every organization, there is an assembly point, of course. Ensure that explosions is avoided at any cost to save lives. Some burn injuries. This is not actually just to know this. This class one, degree one, first degree burns, just reddening or swelling pain. It is in the epidermis, in the top of the skin. And second degree burn, there are two types: so reddening, blistering, pain. It is in superficial dermis. That means little inside. And then class 3 or black, and fourth degree is carburization, may extend. So this is the epidermis that so this is the first degree one. One blister formation, this is the muscles, it can do degree up. So the welding through which the welding current flows through the welding machines, terminals, welding cables, you know, that there is a possibility of shocking if not handled properly. Cables, welding equipment not properly ground, setting wrong parameter, surfaces that conduct electricity, wet workplace and machineries, damp PPEs. Precaution, what are the? So qualified electricians are required to check all these connections, proper earthing, ensure the use of proper PPE, then ensure the use of proper insulated electrode holder. Do not keep the holder hanging with electrode fitted. Prevent welding when welder job or the workplace in wet condition. Then prepare higher voltage at the operator's end, and special care to space. Know how to cut off power supply or current in accidental emergency. Adequate in case of working at height precaution. Some of the precautions, there are 1 million generally not when getting dangerous. So above 2000 milliamp, 2 amps. So you have to remind DR doctor ABCD. That means D for danger. Then this call for help. Okay. Then clean the airway. way. That means we have to open them. Then breathing. Do exposure measures for safety of operation of the processes. It's mainly ionizing radiation such as ionizing alternate. The common product varies with time of exposure, distance from the source, etc. Another dust produced during grinding of stainless steel process. That means we this, but it has so for the time, this we have to it is possible we have to use thorium free electrode, or we have to collect the dust in some dust bag or something like that. Non-ionizing, this is the most important for welding, which is visible light, awfully bright rays, generally 10,000 times of the same glare, causes very deep. That's why we use shielding, shield or helmet. So our more archives are to naked eye, very painful eye irritation, etc. And infrared rays, it affect the bare skin badly. And factors of arc radiation generally depends on welding process and inertia. You see, then naked eye, this is the arc eye. Syndrome and over is the effect of UV radiation, and this is okay. And shaded and you curtain to a light color, then it will reflect this one arc. Where dark shaded EPs or protected throat, etc., no direct exposure of any part of the body to UV and infrared rays, have plenty of flares as intermittently during welding. And treatment, apply cold compress, irrigate eyes with astringent lotion, use appropriate eye drops. If problem persists, consult an eye specialist. And that is the most important, that we have to consult the eye specialist. This is some recommended filter lens. Is 20 to 30, shade 9 was this. Once 11 is okay, then after that 12. But for the meek, for a steel, mild steel, meek with argon, actually that is 11 and 12, say for one is more than and that 300 400, then I think we need with argon, where we need 12, with carbon dioxide we need 13, shade number 13 din. Aluminium with meek, that is also more or less same. So like this, in a TIG welding, so we normally have lesser ampere, so we can use 11, 12, something like this. 11 is okay, 10 is okay, depending upon the amperage. Now, the important thing is musculoskeletal disorder. This normally we neglect. Work-related musculoskeletal disorder, so the whole body is related to musculoskeletal disorders, because this the posture, posture is making like this, because for a long time we have to welding in a stress and repetitive stress injuries, everything can. So demography, structure, genetic logical overload or and another important things for musculoskeletal ergo. What is the posturing is the design equipment and positioning of jaw for efficient and effective workout by operations. Okay, so you can see when we sit, we don't have to sit like this. We have to sit. This is not true. So sitting also like this. So that means we must be straight enough. Different problems of reduce and ensure worker safety, ensure worker health, reduce absenteeism, ensure worker productivity problems. MSD, musculoskeletal disorder, repetitive motion injury, worker dissatisfaction, increase absenteeism, increase turnover, and cause reaching, bending, heavy lifting, using continuing with vibrating equipment, etc. Less gripping strength, less range, loss of muscle, painful pain, and with identity to be free from reduction with full of confidence on tech secures hazard protection, sure of cutter or welder, ensure fire protection and ensure fire watch if required. This should be the responsibility of a skilled supervisor who should prevent the accident and place the safety. And work safety is the safety first, regulation, hazards, health and insurance if there. Safety is not a percentage of our time, it is 100% of our behavior. Work safely and efficiently waiting for you at home. So this is the some code and standards referred and some reference and acknowledgements what I got. And okay, so we came to the end of the first session. So you can see the screen, no? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. I am proceeding. So now we'll go ahead with welding and quality control. And then we'll go for the testing part. So welding codes and standards. Almost all design, welding, fabrication, material, repair, testing, inspection. So everything is covered. For in different countries, formed are recognized by the National Standard Institute of other countries. And not only that, there are many codes and standards available internationally which are related to welding. I am only considering this one. There are so many other codes are there. I'll just name few of them because it's an ocean. So what is the code, what is standard and specification? So code is enforceable by law or by contract, and standard globally accepted how to instruction, and specification must meet requirements by contracts. And what is code written by government or government approved body, and standards is written by public organization or by government body, and specification written by private companies, because our clients or whatever, it may be a government company also. Guidelines, codes, guidelines for design, fabrication, construction, and installation. Like codes are ASME, see boiler or pressure vessel codes are there, BS standards, BT standards organization, international organization for standardization, DIN, all these they are preparing code. And standards, we have ASTM standard, SA standard, ISO standards like this. And specification, we can have all the company, they have their own specification, like Shell DEP, EIL specification is there. There is another thing which is called regulation. Regulation is the law actually that has to be followed. Whether you follow all other things or not, regulation has to be followed. Something like that. Or government imposed something, you have to follow this. These are called regulations. So what are the organization for standardization? ASME is there, AWS is there, API is there. Then ASN for Australia, New Zealand, and then Canadian standard, CSA, BT standard, so International Organization for Standardization, ISO, SEN, German, DIN, Bureau of Indian Standard, IAS, Japanese, GIS, Chinese is there, SSE. So there are and some relevant ASME standard, which is our relevant to our topic, that is welding. But 4 is their rule for construction of heating boiler, 5 is their non-destructive examination, 8 is their rule for construction of pressure vessel, there are division 1, 2, section 9 is there, which is welding, brazing and fusing qualifications, and ASME B31.1, that is for power piping, and 31.3 process piping. There are so many AWS D1.1, that is for the AWS structure 1.4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. There are so many we use that we have 814 covered electrodes for manual metal, arc welding for carbon and carbon manganese steels, 817 part 1 for manual metal arc welding, 817 part 2 is for the oxygen fuel welding, IS 7307 approval test for welding procedures, part 1 for fusion welding of steel, 7310 for the approval test of welders, that means air welder qualification, and this one WPSPQ, and 9595 is the metal arc welding of carbon and carbon manganese steels recommendations. But the Indian codes, Indian standard, what is the problem? These are all old standards, only they are reconfirming. But there is no new changes that are there. So many things you may not find it here inside these codes. And 3600 is the mainly for the testing parts for high standards, like fillet weld, tensile test, there are macro tests for part 9. So these are there. Nowadays we are many companies and many countries around the world is deviating from American standard to now going to ISO standards. So 9606 for the welder qualification, 15609 is for the welding procedure specification, 614 is the specification qualification of welding procedure, and 607 for the specification qualification of welding procedures for metallic metal. These were the general rules. and 5817 welding, fusion welded joints in steel, nickel, titanium and their alloys, this quality level. So these are all normally we require. Now I'm going for the quality. What is quality? Degree to which a set of inherent characteristics fulfills requirements. This is the ISO 9000 as per the ISO 9000 vocabulary. Degree to which a set of inherent characteristics fulfills requirement. And the other definition, the totality of features and characteristics of a product or service that bears its ability to satisfy stated or implied needs. Another one, it is about meeting the needs and expectation of customer, because we have to take care of customer satisfaction. Why quality? For the conformance, of course, of the specification, fitness for use or purpose, value for price paid, support service, etc., etc. There are so many reasons. Quality assurance versus quality control. Sometimes we forget the difference. That is, quality assurance is a management function and it is concerned with the correctness of the processes that produces the deliverables. These functions are administrative and may include such activities as process checklists and audits. So this is before the production level. And quality control is a technical function and is used to verify that deliverables are acceptable, of acceptable quality, and are complete and correct as defined in the product scope. So quality assurance aims on the process used to make the product, and therefore is a proactive control aims in the, and therefore is a reactive process. So quality assurance is a proactive process to prevent the any damage or anything happens afterwards, and quality control is a reactive process, that means after finished products. Now cost of quality, that is the one important thing. So what is cost of quality? There are two types. One is cost of conformance. Cost of conformance is to make a product correct. So money spent to avoid failures. What are that? That's training, document processes, equipment, time to do it right, and appraisal is preventive cost to assess the quality, that is testing, destructive testing loss, and inspection. Quality for what are that? Money spent because of failure. That is, internal failure is rework and scrap, and external failure, liability is warranty, lost business. These are the cost of quality. Now, quality control in welding, what is there? To ensure the proper quality of welding product and to optimize manufacturing cost, the whole welding process must be controlled from the very start. To take all welding quality affecting aspects into consideration, the welding shop is recommended to implement a quality assurance systems. The standard ISO 3834 sets out requirements for manufacturers to meet in order to apply good practices to their welding operations. There are several steps in a welding quality assurance to make sure the welding shop has competent welders. There are standardized ways to test the welders. If required, you also use written welding instructions and or so-called WPS in order to increase the possibility of consistent quality. The full form of WPS is welding procedure specification. What is that? A WPS is a written quality prepared to provide direction for making production weld to code requirements. This is the thing. And a PQR is a procedure qualification record of the welding data used to weld a test coupon. It also contains the results of the test specimen. That means when we prepare on WPS, so first thing we write on WPS on the basis of code, standard, and experience, and whether it is correct, then we have to go for the testing of that parameters, what is written in the WPS, and that is called PQR. If it is okay after testing, then the WPS is okay for going ahead with the welding. Points to be considered for WPS: what code of construction, then detailed drawing, material thickness, configuration, process, contract or customer or TPI, what are PWST requirements, skilled welder, series application, all these are required. What is WPQ? WPQ is the welder performance qualification. That means we have to see that the job is done by some qualified welder. That's why we have to qualify the welder on specified WPS. That means we have a WPS, we have to test the welder whether he can weld on the parameter specified in this WPS or not. There are other related terms in there. PWPS, that is preliminary welding procedure specification, that is same as a WPS before qualifying through PQR. SWPS is standard welding procedure specification, which is available in AWS ASME. WPQR, welding procedure qualification record, same as PQR. This is as per ISO terms. And ISO terms again, WQT, welders qualification test in place of WPQ. And WOPQ is the welding operator performance qualification. At the welder performance qualification, WPQ, WOPQ, welder operator performance qualification. Now, quality parameter for SMAW, you have already learned on the first day. So we have to check to select proper electrode, proper current, proper arc length, and proper travel speed. This we have to maintain. And the low hydrogen electrode, we have to treat the low hydrogen electrode. Baking is required. When you purchase some low hydrogen electrode before use, you have to first thing, it shall be baked in a baking oven from 350 to 450 degree centigrade for 2 hours. That is actually, this is manufacturer recommendations are written on the packet, so you have to follow that one. Then after 2 hours, you have to shift it to the holding oven. Holding oven, there is a temperature is between 100 to 150 degree centigrade. Then from holding oven, welders are taking the electrodes to their quiver or the welding oven, and then they weld. But it is advisable that welders should take as required. That means they should not take too much, and then again it should keep inside the power off, then it may be a problem for the coating. So we have holding again, this maximum 3 cycles can be done like this. After that, it has to be discarded. So advisable is take minimum electrodes for welding. If it is finished, take again. And some are vacuum packed electrodes are available, low hydrogen, that is hermetically sealed, that can be used directly without baking. But after opening the pack, first cycle to go for baking again. Some good practices. So electrode we should keep in this position. So rotation is this type. So if it is in this position, a little straight, then the welding will be like this. And if it is in this type, in the bottom side, then it will be like this, excess displacement. So we have to keep the angle. It is normally in, you can take 30 degree or other side 60 degree, something like that. So you have to maintain this 70 degree. And this is the leg length. 40 degree you can get equal leg length, 30 degree you can get maximum penetration, and for this type of thing, same thing, equal legs with 45 degree and 60 degree maximum penetration. But for cleaning, if this type of multi run is there, it's cleaning is easy. But this is just one good practice. This you can just take a snap, because I should not discuss this one, the different type of ranges of voltage and amperage for different position of different, just to show you. And for the quality parameter for GMAW, we know there are 7 parameters mainly. That means short circuit, electrode wear and diameter, current, voltage, stick out, shielding gas, rate of gas flow. These are the main quality parameters for GMAW. And this also you can take a snapshot, because what are the parameters for voltage ampere, for TIG welding, MIG for spray transfer, MIG for short circuit transfer. You can take, but you can get it in the internet also. Okay, what is inspection? Inspection is that quality control action by means of examination, observation, or measurement to determine the conformance of material parts, components, system structure, as well as processes and procedures with predetermined quality requirements. That means when we are going for the inspection, we have to know what are the quality requirements specified, specification. Before welding, what checks we have to do? Applicable standard we have to check, WPS, PQR, WPQ, drawing, material composition, condition of metal, type of edge preparation, consumable, welding process, clearance dimension, type of backing if required, alignment, tack weld, then preheat if required, calibration status of welding machine and quiver, fulfillment of safety requirement. This we have to check before welding. And this also we have to check before welding. See, if we do one single V, then normally up to 19 millimeter we do single V. Then we have to go for the double V, and this is called root face, is 1 to 2 millimeter, and this root gap maybe 2 to 3 millimeter depending upon the thickness. And if it is more, why we are going for double V? Because if the thickness is more and we go for single V, we have to the angle is getting wider with the thickness, and we have to weld with more material, that is weldment will be more in the gap. So what we do to avoid this additional heat input and all these things, so we do double V, something like that, so that the area of welding is getting lesser as required. So the no additional heat input will be there. Normally up to 19 millimeter we go for 16 19, we go for single V. And more, if the thickness is more, say 50 millimeter, we can go for U, J, something like this type of preparation. During welding, what we check? Welding process parameter, root run, interpass temperature, filler metal or electrode size, interpass cleaning, distortion, and flux or shielding gas flow. This we have to check during the welding. This is for the root. There is a very fine balance between the insufficient penetration and blowing holes. A little wave can help to control the arc. So you can see here, so it is hot. This part is okay. This is insufficient, and this is not gone backside of the plate. And when we are doing the root run, when one electrode is consumed, to start with the second electrode, we should grind the area, the end plate, with the V-like things or tapered things, so other electrodes will start from the back, little back, with the gap, the grinded portion, the tapered portion, so that there will be no fault. Arc length, I just show the this proper arc length is required. That is the thing. So you already came to know this one. See, this is proper arc length, how it is, looks like. This is patterns, you see the welding type. It is a short arc length, is wider and height. So these type of things are there. So we have to maintain the arc length properly. Like travel speed, you see this travel speed is okay. This is the first one, so how it's look like, because people has gone with like this very small. And this is the slow one with wider. So we need the proper things to do. Proper travel speed must be there, which is in written already in the WPS. Now this is current setting. See, this is the okay part. You see how it's look like. If it is high current, you see how it is look. Low current, it is looking like this. So ampere setting, ampere voltage, this must be setting must be proper. And after welding, what we do? Dimensional accuracy, appearance of weld, post-weld heat treatment, if required, evaluation of internal and surface defects, marking of joints and traceability, and update the weld map with the welder number, joint number, etc. So this was the first part for control. Now I'll go for the other one, which is the testing of welded joints. So when we are welding, then after that, the testing requirement is there. So why testing is required? To ensure the satisfactory performance of a welded structure, the quality of the welds must be determined by adequate testing procedures. Therefore, they are proof tested under conditions that are the same or more severe than those encountered by the welded structure in the field. So there are mainly two types of testing. One is destructive testing, one is non-destructive testing. And we'll go for the mainly for the non-destructive. We'll just touch all of this and we'll stress more on the visual part. Okay, destructive testing of weld, what are there? Destructive testing, we don't do, because this is a sample wise. Otherwise, all the material will be lost. So we take the sample, do the destructive test, and then we go for the, we can think that the process is okay. Then we go for the other non-destructive testing and all this for the welded part. So what are the destructive test? Macro is there, fracture test is there, guided bend test, transverse tensile strain, Charpy Venus test. There are so many others, but normally we follow this one. So what is macro? Macro each testing allows the tester to see a cross section of the weld and see the arrangements of the grains in the parent metal and the weld, its macro structure. It can also we apply one chemical here, and then what is that? Normally it is 10% nitric acid and 90% water for carbon steel. And if we etch this one, then we can see this with this type of this solution, and we can see the profile. This is the weldment and this is the defect. You can see the lack of fusion is there, and light shade is there, which is the HAZ, that is heat affected zone. Then we can have the fracture test. Normally we do for the fillet weld, just do a saw cut here and then blow hammer from this side, and after breaking is looking like this, and we can see here line of fusion, if it is if at all it is fused or not. So it is like this, it should come the penetration like this. If no penetration is there, it will break the plain plate. You can see the plain plate, not like this. Then guided bend test, as per the code, small strips are cutting out from the welding piece, and then it may be bend, root bend is there. If we press here and here, then it is root bend from root side. And then face bend means if it is like this, and side bend means side bend, not like this. Side bend is when we turn it out, turn 90 degree and then bend it. And it is bent almost 90 degrees to see if there is any fault or something. Because we have to, if it is failed, if it is failed, welding also failed, we have to see what is the diameter and where it is failing. All this has to be taken care as per the code. Otherwise, we cannot tell that it is a failure. And transverse tensile, you have seen maybe that there are machines are there. So it's some pieces are prepared as per the code, and we have to one side it is fixed, another side it is pulling. After pulling, it is just getting larger, and then in some portion it is fails. So there we can find the tensile strength, what is that, and yield strength we can find through this type of thing. This is, as I told, not for the all the pieces. This is for the samples, like when we are doing the PQR and all these things. So we do this one. So to confirm this welding procedure is okay. And another is Charpy-V-notch test. This is normally to check the this notch toughness, and maybe mainly for the low temperature carbon steels, LTCS or something like that. So how it switches on minus 29 degree, minus 46 degree. So notch toughness is checking. It's two, something like that. So we do it. 2 millimeter deep notch is there. Oh, sorry. This is the standard Charpy Venus specimen. It's 55 millimeter square, and two mm is the notch deepness. Now we will go for the non-destructive part, and that part, other part, destructive part is normally done at the laboratory. So it is not in our hand, but the non-destructive part, that part we can see and we can perform by ourselves also. So it is the evaluation, it is the process of inspecting, testing or evaluating material components or assemblies for discontinuities or difference in characteristics without destroying the serviceability of the part or system. That means after NDT we can use the material as it is. So use of NDT in welding. So there are during fabrication, due to wrong choice of material, there are different types of these defects occurs actually. Due to wrong welding procedures, due to inadequate control of welding procedures, all are there. And during in-service inspection or repair, so we have to follow all these, plus degradation, that is also we have to check in NDT. What is discontinuity and what is defect? Discontinuity is an interruption in the normal physical structure of an article, example cracks, seams, porosity. Discontinuity thus interferes with the usefulness of the article. Say once fatter is there or once scratch is there, that is discontinuity. But whether it is a defect, that will depend on the code requirement or specification. So all the discontinuities are not the defect, but all the defects are discontinuities. What are the main types of NDT process we use? Liquid penetrating test, magnetic particle test, ultrasonic test. These are the normal eddy current test, there are leak tests, there are so many things, but normally we do this for the welding. So liquid penetrant testing, this will come like this. A liquid with high surface wetting characteristics is applied to the surface of the part and allowed time to dip into surface breaking defects. The excess of liquid is removed from the surface of the part, is applied to pull the trapped penetrant out the defect and spread it on the surface where it can be seen. Visual inspection is the final step in the process. The penetrant used is often loaded with a fluorescent dye and the inspection is done under UV light to increase test visibility. That means when it is a fluorescent dye, we have to use UV light. But in the normal dye, we can check. So what are the scope of this liquid penetrant testing? To detect discontinuities that are open to the surface of solid and essentially non-porous material. It should be non-porous material and open to the surface. And principle, as I already told, it is mainly due to the capillary action. The ability of penetrant to flow over a surface and enter cavities depends on cleanliness of the surface. That means first we have to clean the surface, configuration of cavity, cleanliness of cavity, size of surface opening, surface tension of penetrant, wettability of penetrant, viscosity and contact angle. All these are required. This is a capillary action just shown, and this is the reverse capillary action when we are applying the dye here. and this penetrant is applied, then dwell time maybe 7 minutes to 10 minutes, then excess penetrant is removed. Don't spray directly on the piece, the solvent, so you can and then wipe it up, and then developer is applied, and then we can finishing, then we can clean with the post cleaning after evaluation. And I think yes, so I am not playing the video now. A non-destructive examination, magnetic particle testing that you have seen. So the part is magnetized, finely milled iron particles coated with a dye pigment are then particles are attracted to magnetic flux clustered to form an indication directly over the discontinuity. This indication can be visually detected under proper lighting condition. You have to know this one. This is applicable to ferromagnetic materials only, ferromagnetic, because you know this magnetic particle testing to detect surface and subsurface discontinuity. So subsurface means up to 2 millimeter. It is below the surface, it is up to 2 millimeter, it can detect. So this is the difference between and current AC for detecting surface discontinuity and DC for discontinuities. Just a small video.
So, there's a magnetic parking. We're going to start over here. One of the things that we teach our technicians is the proper technique to apply the particles. As you apply the particles, you want to actually just float them on. You don't want to dump them on with a cannon, such as that. You just want to be able to lightly float the particles on. And the same thing with a puffer. When you blow the particles away, you want to be a little tender and a little sensitive to make sure that you don't down across the plate, making sure that we have overlap. So I make sure that I test 100% of this particular component. I don't see anything there. I'm moving down again.
So overlapping is there.
And as I apply this here, of an indication along the toe of the well. To be about a 2-inch-long crack in the infected zone. So as I talked about before, that it's important to know the techniques and the proper technique of blowing the particles off. Because if I use too much force, especially on a painted blade as opposed to an unpainted blade, I can actually blow the particles away and you no longer see the crack. So again, it's important to know the proper technique of floating the particles on and watching them form. Removal with the blower. So this completes this.
Yesterday you have seen the ultrasonic technique also, I think. Inspection of pulse echo. Sound waves are introduced into a material and surface or floss. Displayed various versus time specter can visualize a cross section of the specimen showing the depth of features and reflect sound. This actually this experience is required to detect actually for the ultrasonic. You see. You see, this is the cracks, and here the sound going like this. This one is the back wall echo, but where there is a crack, it is coming in between. Actually, this is depends upon the piezoelectric. It's a compound, coupling compound. Piezoelectric crystal and damping mass, and this is the normal probe, and this is the defect. So it when it is coming here, this is the full echo. This is the full echo, 10 millimeter plate. If it is the 10 millimeter plate, so there is a full back wall echo. And here it is, when it is coming here, so 4 millimeter, there is a echo, and that is the defect. So actually, this is this requires a there is a mistake with the flaws or some porous things, something like that. Principle piezoelectric effect. Effect. What is that? The conversion to mechanical energy and effect on which this probes are based. Sound wave flaws. Sound waves. So it is going down for the if there is no no defect or it is bouncing. What is the echoes from flaws and cluster and all these things. Scanning direction, see there is a fault in between red one. So this angle probes, four positions are there. So we have to go like this, and then after that it will be returned. So we have to check all along from four sides. So there may be, we can find a fault. This is for the T-joints here. So what we have to do? See, here I can find from this side. Here it is going back, something like that. Maybe it will come here, maybe. So we have to know. So all from here also we have to check, from here also check, everywhere we have to check. We have to scan actually, so that we can find the defect, if it is there. Like say if something is there like this, some defect, and this is like this, the ray, it will not find. So we have to, from this side we have to scan. So everywhere, from every location, we have to scan. Testing, nothing to say about this, nothing more to say. The radiation used in radiography testing is a higher energy, shorter wavelength version of the electromagnetic waves that we see as visible light. The radiation can come from an X-ray generator or a radioactive source. These are the high frequencies for X-ray, gamma ray, like this. This rays. The film radiography, normally what we use, the part is placed between the radiation source and a place of a piece of film. That means this is the part what we have to test, and this is the film and this is the source. The film darkness or density will vary and reaches to the reaching the film. So through the test piece. Now less exposure is whitish, more exposure it is blackish. So when it is there, it will come dark. This is the just X-ray tube design. This is one is the cathode. Number four is the cathode rays. It's going there. Number three is the anti-cathode. Number two is the anode, and five is X-ray. Just inside this one. Normally we don't care about this because it is already done. And this is the another source is, of course, radio. One thing I should tell you that normally people are telling X-ray in radiography, with the isotope also, X-ray is going on. It is not like that. First thing is radiographic testing. There are two types. One is with X-ray, one is with gamma ray, that is with the isotope, a radioactive isotope. So it is fitted here, and from the distance we operated here to the place where it is required. And this is a collimator. Collimator is directs the rays to the point. And gamma ray source, there are cobalt is there, the cobalt 60, which is half life is 5.3 years. That means if it is a 100 curie source, so after 5.3 years it will be 50 curie. Iridium 192 is there, half life is 74 days. That means after 37 days you will find it maybe 60 curie iridium source, you will find it 30 curie after 74 days. selenium 75, this powder type, normally these two is used, iridium and cobalt. Iridium is maximum and half life is 120 days for selenium. And for higher thickness, cobalt 60 is preferable. And geometric relationship, you see, this is the source focal point, that is from one point is coming the source. So it is ranging all the, like this subject, and there is no penumbra, that means the shaded portion. But when the source focal spot is a little wider, then there will be penumbra. Even for the distance also, it will come like this. Even from the less distance also, it will come like this shaded portion. So we have to know the what is the exact focal spot required for this particular radiography. Then what factors, more factors, resolution, geometrical uncertainty, and subject uncertainty, these are there, and contrast, exposure control, and choice of energy. Actually, these are all ultrasonic and all these things, so it is not possible for 5 minutes, 10 minutes. I cannot tell you everything, just to know the requirements. Radiographic technique, this is single wall penetration, there is source inside over the bigger pipes, source inside, that is panoramic. So if we put films outside, so at a time we can take the radiography, and this is the single wall penetration, only one penetration. This also, this type of film is there, and this is also can be done where the source is outside, film is inside. This is for the bigger one, of course. This double wall penetration, what is there? Double wall, single image, when the source is there on the pipe or a little above the pipe, and film is below other side, so it has to pass through double wall. And if it is little angle, that is also double wall, single image, it is alternative, it is little angle. And double wall, double image, mainly up to two inch pipe we do, that is it is the razor coming like this. So in one film I can see both the surface, it is elliptical. Actually, it is the image is coming elliptical, that is a double wall, double image. And the safety time, so we have to know the source side, distance, we have to stand in a safe distance, and shielding there must be there. This something the half value layer, that means if you use a 30 curie or 60, so in a 44.5 millimeter concrete wall, other side it will be 15 curie, and for cobalt 60 it is a concrete size is 60.5, and normally we use lead. Lead is the good conduct, good this one for the sources, radiography, and this restricts. So 4.8 millimeter is the for iridium. For 30 curie source will be 15 curie after that, and cobalt 60 12.5. like half value layer for x-ray, there are different. See, for say for 300, lead is 1.47 millimeter, and concrete is 31.2 millimeter. Normally in project sites we do concrete bunkers inside that, radiography can be done. Now we are going the most important one, visual testing. The most basic and common inspection method, tools include fibroscope, boroscope, magnifying glass, and mirror. So first thing, when we complete one welding, what we have to do, we have to check visually. So visual inspection is the most important and basic inspection. So if we found some problem in visual, so we don't have to go for other things. And if not found, then only other radiography or magnetic particle or liquid penetrant testing is required. of visual examination, a non-destructive examination method used to evaluate an item by observation, used to determine the surface condition of an article, alignment of matting surface, compliance with physical requirements, welded joints, usually the first method employed for locating suspected defects. Locating suspected defects, what I told. Also, the oldest and most commonly used NDT method, and cheaper, of course. So, why visual examination can be used to inspect for surface breaking discontinuities, cracks, holes, corrosion. Does not require special equipment other than good eyesight, optical and mechanical aids optional to improve inspection quality and low cost, of course. Vision requirement, near vision, ability to do Jigar chart, J1 letters, or equal less than 12 inch or 1 feet. Color vision, ability to distinguish colors or shades of gray used in examination. Recommended examination distance is always between 10 to 12 inch. That means you should not go less than that or more than that. It is the good distance from where we can do a checking, visual inspection, 10 to 12 inch. So direct visual exam, maximum distance is 24 inch, maximum. Angle not less than 30 degrees, then we can miss something. And intensity of light not less than 1000 lux, visual aids, gauges, magnifying glass, mirrors. Mechanical aids, micrometer, caliper, depth gauge, thread pitch gauge, filler gauge, weld gauge. So all these we are using normally in visual examination. These are some tools, you know. And remote visual examination, boroscope. So basic visual instrument mounted in a metal tube, normally provided with an illumination source. Most available equipment is designed to be interfaced with video and 35 millimeter camera system. That means if we inspect inside one pipe, say maybe 5 meter long pipe is there is a joint, so we can use boroscope even for the cleanliness checking and all these things. Fibroscope is flexible endoscope, is in even for the medical disease. And videoscope, small flexible microscope that use a video sensor to adjust magnification. Video images easily lends itself to digitizing. For welding, normally we use boroscopes. This other visual examination tool. This is the portable video examination inspection tools. Portable one example, you know, regarding the car and all these things. Below the car, something is going on, mirror something for checking. That is also a type of visual examination. And where people cannot go, we can send the robot for inspection. And what is the visual inspection of what are the things we can check? Is crack, bead shift, burn through, porosity, pinhole, waviness, undercut, and weld appearance. We cannot check inside the weld. Inside the weld, it is we cannot check of your ultrasonic testing. This is some fillet weld acceptance criteria. If it is, this is the size, this is the size. You see. This is W width. It's 8 mm, less than equals to 8 mm. Then maximum convexity we can allow up to 2 mm, and 8.5 mm maximum we can allow 3 mm, and above 25 mm we can allow maximum up to 5 mm. This is the general norms. Undersize weld, it is inside. This is excessive convex, and this is excessive undercut here, this side, and this is overlap. This side is rounded, you see, rounded. This is called overlap. This is incomplete fusion, just some figures only. And this is for the butt weld. Yes, and R is the reinforcement. So acceptable groove weld profile in and this is the acceptable profile. And what are these? This is excessive convexity inside. This is insufficient throat, is down. This is excessive undercut and overlap. You see, this part, this portion is called overlap. Just some examples. And visual inspection, we can see scattered porosity. You can see by open eyes. We can see this one, connecting crack. This is overlap. This is round portion. It is coming to the plate again. And this is the undercut. And this is slag. And this is spatter. This we can see in the just open eye. And this is incomplete fusion. There is not yet fused. You can see the plate edge. It is not yet fused. So this is all more or less. Just I'll show one video on visual inspection of words.
Inspection of words, its advantages and disadvantages. Visual inspection is performed to know whether the word penetration and contour are satisfactory. The word surface and joints are examined with the help of a magnifying lens. Today's optical systems may include special probes, spectrometers, real-time imaging, and analysis using notebook computers. Visual inspection is carried out in three stages, namely visual inspection before welding, visual inspection during welding, and visual inspection after welding. In visual inspection before welding, the following factors should be ensured: weldable quality of the material to be welded, properly prepared edges of the work pieces for welding, proper cleaning of the base metal, setting of proper root cam, current setting and position of welding, need for an aging or proper alignment. In welding, the following visual inspections are made: studying the sequence of weld deposit, examining whether each weld is done satisfactorily before making the next run in multi-run welding, checking the shape of the lead, angle of electrode, control of spatters, amperage, speed of travel, and arc length. Checking the manipulation of electrode, blow pipe, and filler material. Observing keenly the mold and pool for proper fusion. Inspection needs to be done after welding to identify the following flaws: improper shape or profile of the weld, surface defects of the weld, undercuts and overlaps, excessive convexity of contour, overrun, and distortion of the work pieces, unfilled cavity. Main advantage of visual inspection is that it is the simplest, fastest, and economical method. Main disadvantage of visual inspection is that internal defects cannot be determined. Thus, visual inspection of one disadvantages.
Okay, to remember, an inspector shall have knowledge on the subject, shall follow the codes and standards, able to take decision by his own, shall not be diverted by others, shall have good attitude, shall not be biased, and shall be ethical. These all the qualities must be an inspector must have all these qualities. So this more or less I have completed in time, I think.
Sir, the first question is, what is proof load?
Proof load. See, actually, we have not discussed regarding the laboratory testing, as I told you. So, because I also don't have sufficient knowledge on laboratory testing, but proof load, we have not discussed today, actually.
Right, sir. The next question is, what is the solution for CO2 welding splatter?
CO2 welding splatter, actually this is already you have done in the first day, but splatter means there are, you know, three types of metal transfer. One is for the globular transfer, one is spray transfer, one is the short circuit transfer. If we do the globular transfer, there is a chance of splatter. So we have to avoid globular transfer. That is one thing. And another thing, there are anti-splatter sprays are used for this GMAW welding. So that also, after sometimes welders are using this one to the nozzles and all this, so that you can avoid the splatter. Yes.
Right, sir. The next question is, how to minimize tapper cutting and plasma cutting?
Tapper cutting.
Yes.
See, plasma cutting, as I told you, it is 90 degree. This plasma cutting is done 90 degree. So, perpendicular to the plate to be cut. So there should not be any taper cutting if you have fixed the nozzle in some wrong direction or something like that, then only it will come. Otherwise, if you fix it properly, perpendicular, any taper cutting should not be.
Right, sir. Does visual inspection is sufficient for welding up to 3 mm sheet thickness?
Our question is not clear. Actually, visual inspection, why 3 mm? I can do for 100 mm, 200 mm. There's no restriction. Visual inspection can be done only on the outer surfaces. So whether it is a 3 mm or 100 mm, no matter. But inside defects cannot be found through the visual inspection.
Right, sir.
Is it clear? I think it is clear, because visual inspection only on the outer surfaces, top surfaces. So the thickness is not a matter. We have to reach there. See, sometimes pipe welding, so there are cross-country pipelines that they are in that in the ditches. So why you have to check the bottom portion? Then we use the mirror. So mirror, something like that. So outer surface can be visually checked whether it is not related to any thickness.
Right, sir. How to reduce the burr found in HRPO 8 mm thickness material cutting in laser?
This is very difficult for me to tell. In the laser, normally burrs are not there. If the this one, no. So you have some sample, and then you do the reproduce the same with that. There should not be any bar, because as I know, the plastic also cut through this. There may be some adjustment, something. Otherwise, laser cutting is best of the lot, and you can find it very smooth things. So it is very difficult for me to tell why, if some bar is there.
Right, sir. Mr. Chi, you have raised your hand. Do you have any question for us? Okay, moving
on
to the
next. He can write, yeah.
Moving on to the next question. Can you suggest the welding electrode for cast steel to IS 2062 and cast steel to SS304?
No, I'll not suggest anything. Different manufacturer, electrode manufacturers will producing different types of electrodes, but the some, of course, the specification is there as me section 2 part C. So you have to check what are the elements there, what are the casting elements, then only you can find the proper one. If it is normal combustion, normal alloy steel, I know what is to be done, is 7018 or 8018 or whatever, maybe. But the cast steel or cast this one, you have to know what is there inside. So better elements there inside the material, and then only you check the particular some manufacturer what their they have in their own.
Right, sir. The next question is there any difficulty found in MS? If there any difficulty found in MS material weld with GI material, if yes, which prevention can we take?
GI material.
Right.
Galvanized. Have to grind. If you want to weld normal steel with so galvanized steel, then it is better. It is not better. It is always preferable. You have to remove the zinc coatings. Otherwise, you know, the first thing is there, the fumes, zinc fumes, which is dangerous to the worker and the welding something. So better to grind. That is the precaution you have to take.
Right, sir. Mr. Manoj Kumar, you have raised your hand. Do you have any question for us? Mr. Manoj Kumar, raise your hand. Do you have any question for us?
What is the difference between lift and
not audible?
Not audible.
Tell him to write the question.
Silent, I think it's flashing with two other devices in the same area.
Echoing.
Right, sir. Mr. Manoj Kumar, we request you to please type in your question as there is some noise disturbances from the area you are trying to communicate. Moving on to the next question. Which course is proven in the field of welding inspection?
Which code?
Is proven in the field of welding inspection.
Code, your CODE, code.
CORSE,
code. There is, you know, there is ASNT, visual examination is there, VT course. That is normally 3 days course. You can check with the ISNT in India, or there are so many labs are there. So you can do the course for visual examination. It is normally 3 days course.
Right, sir. What is the optimum angle of electrode with weld surface to ensure minimum defects and best quality of welding?
See, I can tell the 60 to 70 degree, even less than that, but for the better one. But as I showed you, 45 degree for if it is lying this flat position, 45 degree. So it is depend upon the position you are welding. So when you are welding a pipe, what you will do? So from the bottom, its angle is changing. So it is very difficult to tell, but for the horizontal and all these things, so above 30 degree, even 60 degree is okay. And welder has to ensure that proper penetration, proper leg length he is finding. This it will depend upon the position where the piece is located and the position of the welding. It is 1G, 2G, 1F, 2F. So it will vary normally. Not right. The 90 degree, not sure.
Right. Mr. Manoj Kumar has written the question which he wanted to ask you in person. I'll read it out to you. What is the difference between MIG, MAG and CO2?
It's a good question. Normally, for GMAW, gas metal arc welding, this is the American term. And MIG or MAG, that is the European standard terms. It is 130, 135, they are telling it's like this. Normally, we tell is MIG welding. When it is welded with carbon dioxide, when it is welded with argon, it is a wrong term. MIG welding is with argon. And when you are using carbon dioxide, that is called MAG welding or argon carbon dioxide mixture, any mixed gas, that is also called MAG welding. That is, one is metal inert gas, that is argon, pure argon. Another is metal active gas with carbon dioxide or mixed gas. So carbon dioxide, when we use carbon dioxide, it is a MAG process.
Right, sir. Can we do ultrasonic test on a SS304?
Yes, possible.
Please share shades of glass required for goggles for welding.
I already shown one slide. What I'll tell, okay, normally in SMAW, normally, and GM something like that, and even or something, but is go to Google and what, because I have. Thank you for this session, and I thank Tata Steel and Versus, and of course NWRTI for giving me the chance for this one. Thank you. I think I can log out now.